I like to talk about the Lord Jesus Christ all the time, but sometimes it's necessary also to talk about the enemy of God and the enemy of man, Satan. Why? Well, because Paul, the Apostle Paul, said that we are not ignorant of his devices. In other words, once you know the devices and the strategies of the enemy, you know how to defend yourself. Of course, the best and most safe position in which you can find yourself in to counterattack the enemy is to be in Christ. And this to be in Christ is not by any means something that you and I can do by religion or personal efforts. You get in Christ when you believe that the Lord Jesus Christ died for your sins, he was buried, and was risen for your justification. And by believing this glorious reality that he died, he paid for all your sins, and so then is imputed to you his righteousness the moment you believe by faith, the Spirit of God himself puts you in Christ. So that's a transaction that is supernatural, is an operation of God. That's something I like to underline. I like that we understand that with the things of the Lord, unless it's an operation of God, then it's an operation of the flesh, our flesh, and then it's no good. That's why religion is no good. Doesn't matter the label. You can call yourself, Pentecostal, Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, or Buddhist, or Islamist, or Judaic, or New Judaism, all these children of Yah, whatever. You're just in a big error of the flesh, because the flesh is tricky. The flesh, it doesn't know anything. It doesn't understand the things of God. The spiritual man does not. The man that is not spiritual, the man that has not the Spirit of God, doesn't understand the spiritual things because they are spiritually discerned. By the way, let's go back here. Satan. By no means whatever I'm going to say here is exhausted. This is a subject very big. But let's see one important scripture in the Old Testament, in the prophetic scriptures to Israel, talking about Satan, when he said, you know, in Isaiah 14:12, that this guy, who is his name was Lucifer, which means light bearer, you know, he was shining one, whatever. This guy, a cherub, he had a position given to him by God, very, very important, but something happened in himself, in his heart. He decided to go against God. Now, people say, you know, he's very intelligent, but I don't know. When I think that somebody might be a celestial being or a terrestrial being goes against God, I start to think that this guy, whoever he is crazy, is mad, and not necessarily intelligent, because going against God and seeking to be defeated is the same thing. You know, God is the Almighty, the El Shaddai, you know, the Almighty. You want to go against God, you really got something wrong in your brain. Anyway, in Isaiah 14:12, we read the prophet is speaking by inspiration of the Spirit, of course, the Holy Spirit of God, because all the Bible has been written under inspiration by the Holy Ghost. And it says, "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations?" And Isaiah 14:13, 14 and 15 says, "For thou hast said in thy heart," "For thou hast said in thine heart," number one, "I will ascend into heaven." Two, "I will exalt my throne above the stars of God." Three, "I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north." Four, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. 5. I will be like the Most High. Now this is his program, a 5 points program. That's why often, you know, Satanists or people that say they worship Satan, what a waste of time, use the pentagon or the five-pointed star as the symbol, you know, 5 points of rebellion of Satan, of Lucifer, against the Lord. Now, the Lord answers to him, to his 5 points. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. You know, I said to you before, you go against God, you're stupid. That's it. Easy as. You want to be on God's side, not on the wrong side against him. But all humanity is against God. Even the very religious people that go to church every Sunday, you know, and go through rituals and follow traditions of men, they really maybe don't realize they are against God. Because we cannot be for God unless we are in Christ. I know this is very drastic, but hey, I didn't say this. You can read the 13 letters of Paul and see for yourself. Let's see if I can go there. And the 13 letters of Paul. Yes, okay. Here. Yeah, from Romans to Philemon, these 13 letters, we have very important information concerning the body of Christ, concerning the new creature, concerning the grace dispensation, the dispensation of grace, concerning the wonderful work of salvation that God himself performed on behalf of lost humanity. Tell you now, you cannot find salvation by grace through faith as a gift by the cross in the other books of the Bible. I mean, the Bible is a very big book, 66 books, you know, from Genesis to Revelation, and they all inspired by God, so no problem there. It's all word of the Lord, is inspired, and I use the only Bible which I consider to be the Bible, the word of God, perfectly preserved, the King James Bible. And I have no problem in reading any part of the scripture and know that what is written there is the truth. Like, you know, I go here in Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. I don't care, honestly, if the entire planet, plane, you know, in the entire world doesn't believe this, and they rather believe that they come from monkeys, or evolution, I call it evolution, or from the Big Bang, you know, there's something explode. For me, that's completely idiocy. I can see very clearly there is a creator. His name is God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. And I read this and I believe it. I got no problem. Some people have. I don't. Or if I go and read him, I don't know, 1 Kings 9:1, and it came to pass when Solomon had finished the building of the house of the Lord, and the king's house, and all Solomon's desire, which he was pleased to do. I know that this is truth, that the Lord appeared to Solomon the second time, as he had appeared unto him at Gibeon. That's it. I have no problem in believing this. I believe that all it is written is the truth. In fact, I believe so much that I take very seriously this command here in 2 Timothy 2:15, where the Apostle Paul, which is my apostle, because he's one apostle to the one body, the body of Christ, of which by the grace of God I'm part, he says, study, to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. See, this Bible is the word of truth, but needs to be rightly divided. Meaning, you got to know what part of this scripture applies to you. In other words, you know, Yes, I believe all the Bible is the word of God, and I believe every word there is inspired. But I know that I'm not required, for example, I'm not required to approach God through sacrifices. So I'm not killing lambs and oxes and oxen, you know, and bulls to appease God for my sin. I'm not confessing my sin because all my sins have been forgiven once and for all by the Lord Jesus Christ, by his cross. I have received the atonement now. So, for example, I don't say that the Lord is my shepherd, Psalm 23, because I'm not a sheep, neither am part of the flock of the Lord, which is Israel. But I know that he is the shepherd of Israel, and no problem. For me, is my Lord, Savior, the Redeemer, and is the head of the body, of which by his grace I'm part. He's my Savior, he's my Lord, you know what I mean? So I studied to see what is the part of the scripture that is for me as part of the body of Christ. And as I said before, I find here in Romans, Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, Timothy, 1st and 2nd Titus, and Philemon, the revelation of the mystery. And in fact, in Romans 16, verse 25, that's how we preach, and that's how I preach the Lord Jesus Christ, when Paul says in Romans 16, 24 and on, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Now, to him that is power, that is of power to establish, please notice, not establish, but establish you according to my gospel. So, I got one gospel to follow. It's not the gospel that I found in the four gospels, neither the gospel of Moses, nor the kingdom gospel, but the gospel of Paul and the preaching of Jesus Christ. Okay, so we preach, I preach Jesus Christ, but not according to his earthly ministry that we read in the four gospels, neither according to the prophetic ministry which Peter and John and James and Jude preach in the Jewish letters, but according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. You see, going back to what I started, which is this Satan, you know, Satan didn't know this. He didn't know that God had a mystery kept secret to himself. If he would have known, he would not have crucified Christ, I tell you now. Because the moment he crucified Christ, he practically shot his foot. Why? Because by the cross of Christ, sinners like me and like you can be saved by grace. Without Israel, without the law, without covenant, without rituals and traditions and rigmarole, whatever. Just by faith. But first of all, by grace, through faith. The faith is the way to exercise, you know, this belief that Christ has done all that was necessary for the salvation. So Satan didn't know this, and his devils, because, you know, the word demon is not in the King James, his devils, because he's the devil with many devils, his minions, didn't know. But I do, because I read Paul and I see that this mystery that was kept secret since the world began, but now it's made manifest. And by the scripture of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. So we got an obedience to exercise now, but not to the law, because we can't obey the law, but the obedience of faith, believing. Obey by believing what God declares about his son. But Satan was this five-point programs to practically take the place of God or be like God and practically rule the entire humanity and the entire system, the world, heaven and earth, so to say. Eh? He didn't know that God was going to smash him through this. And he did. Even though now, you know, we don't see, you know, everything going hunky-dory, because in Colossians we read, let's see, yeah. let's see, Colossians 2:1. Oh, yes, yes, yeah. Beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the traditions of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. You understand? Because in him, in Christ, dwells the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. In other words, you know, any man or woman that has this fantasy that he or she can approach God on the basis of their own works, religious works or non-religious, whatever, intellectual works, artistic works, works of the flesh, according to philosophy, vain deceit, tradition of man, the rudiments of the world, they really, you know, they are there with the fairies, because God is holy. He's very holy, which means not holy that is wonderful, but means that there is no evil, no sin in him. It's impossible. He's perfect goodness. He's perfect. It is perfect. And no man on this planet is. And only one man who walked this planet was perfect in his life, every single moment. That's the Lord Jesus Christ in his humanity. Don't ever forget that Jesus Christ is 100% man and 100% God. And he's perfect. He's the perfect man of God according to the heart of God. The sinless Son of God. Now, then, you and I can be not only approaching God, but be in God, be in Christ, when we believe and receive the gospel of Christ, because the Holy Spirit puts us into the body of Christ. You see in Ephesians 1, let's see. You see, far above all principality, you know, Jesus Christ and power and might and dominion, every name that is named, not only in this world but also in that which is to come. And here we read, yeah, that we were without Christ, you know, but the moment we have believed, something happened, you know, something wonderful has happened. Yeah, we have redemption through his blood. You know, redemption means we've been bought back. You may say, what do you mean? Well, we were under the sway of the enemy. We were in bondage to Satan, to the flesh, to the world. And we have been bought back. We have been redeemed. And we receive the forgiveness of sins, not only of sins, but the sins, all the sins that we ever commit or will commit. Because sadly, but truly, we all sin every day, you know, even with a thought. Because in our flesh, we are alienated by God. But God is good, and he has made known unto us the mystery of his will, you see, which is according to his good pleasure, which is purposed in himself, that in the fullness of times he might gather together in one things all in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. Yeah? In whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ, in whom Christ you also trusted after you heard the word of truth. So, you know, Satan is trying to do anything so that you will not hear the word of truth, but you will hear fantasy, philosophy, you know, rudiments of the world, human behavior interpretation. I mean, you know, you really don't need that. You need to hear the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. You see, when you hear the word of truth, 1 Corinthians 15:1-4, that Christ died for your sins, was buried, was risen for your justification, and that's it. Nothing to add, nothing to take from it. This is the gospel of salvation, in whom also after that you believe, so you believe, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. That's what happens. The Holy Spirit of God, unseen. You cannot feel it. You can't see it. You can't smell it. It doesn't come under the the spectrum of the five senses that we have, you know. The Holy Spirit seals you. You understand? Seals you into the body of Christ and puts the seal of God in you. You belong to God. In fact, that seal of God, the seal of the Holy Spirit, is the earnest, the down payment of our inheritance. Like, you know, God says, for now, get this by faith, you know. I do this, but you're going to receive an inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of His glory. In other words, you know, into the future when we finally will be with the Lord in the heavenly places. But, hey, Satan is working hard now in this dispensation of God's grace. Let's see what he's done. Okay, I'm going to look here. This word. Be patient. Transform. Yeah. Let's see what is done. Oh, look here. This guy, Satan, you see, is transformed into an angel of light. That's his program now. That was his program, the 5 point in the Old Testament. But now, he's got this program, is transformed into an angel of light. Listen here. And no matter, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. So here we see the tremendous trickery of Satan in this dispensation of God's grace. God says, look, you are a sinner. Romans 3:23, all sin and come short of the glory of God. And Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. Sorry for the interruption. Yes, you know, he's got this program. God says, you know, the wages of sin is death. And so practically, you got to know the bad news. You know, all sinners, all dead, and sins and trespasses all going to hell. But God says the good news. But the gift of God, you see, the wage of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So God is telling you, is telling me, I give you a gift, eternal life. You don't need to any religion. Ephesians 2:8-9. For by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So God is telling you, I save you by grace. I give you a gift, a free gift, salvation. And you say, what have I got to do? Because, you know, you straight away think, works, I got to do something. God said, nothing. Simply believe what I've done, what Christ has done when he went to die on that cross. No one understood why in the world, you know, this wonderful person had to go and die on the cross, okay? And when he risen for your justification. The moment you believe this, God imputes righteousness. Jesus Christ's righteousness imputed to you. No more sin, because sin has been put on Christ's account. So he imputed the sin of the world, my sin, your sins, everybody, to Christ on the cross. So the moment you receive this, there is an exchange. You receive imputed righteousness. You understand? So it is true that he died for all men of the past, the present, the future. But only those who believe and so receive imputed righteousness will be saved. Those who don't believe this and reject this, sadly but truly, they are lost. So God is saying, I don't want anything. I don't want you pray, fast and pray, go to church, pay tithes, confess with your mouth, believe in your heart, walk the aisle, shake the pastor's hand, you know, reform, repent, become perfect, because he knows that's useless, because Christ has done it all. He says, just simply believe. But the enemy, oh, no, 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 no. They, I must do something. They don't need to hear this word of truth. I will hide it. How does he hide it? He's transformed into an angel of light. And he's got his ministers transformed as ministers of righteousness. But they end, just like Satan, will be according to their works. They're preaching a work-based religion, a work-based salvation. They said to you, yes, Jesus died on the cross, but, they put this, but you have now to walk the straight and narrow, and you got to be kind and good every day. But you might even try, and then you fail, and then you fail, and then you confess your sins, and then you enter in this crazy circle, you know, like a wheel of you sin, you confess, you cry, you repent, you sin, and all your life is a misery, really, because what kind of salvation is that? It's not. It's anything but salvation. On the other hand, the gospel of grace, the gospel, the word of truth tells you, you are forgiven. You are accepted in the beloved. You are part of the body of Christ now. You're a member of Christ. God, the Holy Spirit, seals you. He baptizes you, not in water, that was for Israel, okay, but into the death of Christ. You are dead with Christ. You are buried with Christ. We risen with Christ to a new life. You are part of the new creature, which was a mystery, which has been revealed to Paul that no one knew. So forget all this denomination, 40,000 of them, they're splitting hair, baptizing in water with sprinkling, no, into the bathtub, no, in the ocean. There is no baptism in water for believers nowadays. They're tricking you, you know, that stuff for Israel. You see what Satan is doing with his ministers, as ministers of righteousness, they are preaching to you a gospel of works. Amen. You're going to split hell wide open unless you simply reject this and believe the gospel of Christ. And so Satan is transformed in an angel of light. What happens with light? If you look at one light straight into your eyes, you are blinded. But what about you look at two lights, three lights, 10 lights, 1,000 lights? That's what Satan is doing. He's blinding people with his lights. You know, you go in church, they don't say, let's all worship Satan. They say, let's all worship Jesus. But they are preaching another Jesus. What? Another Jesus? Yes. Let's see. Another Jesus. Another Jesus. Paul said, for he that comes preaches another Jesus. What? Yes. Whom we have not preached, or if you receive another spirit, which ye have not received, or another gospel, which you have not accepted, you might well bear with him. Was already happening in the time of Paul, because Satan, with his strategy, was already working, blinding people, preaching another Jesus, another gospel, another spirit. What do you mean? Are you talking about the Jehovah's Witness? No, I'm talking about the Baptists. I'm talking about the Pentecostal, the Methodist, the Presbyterian, the Episcopalian, whatever it is. They're all following Peter and the 11. They're all in Acts 2:38. Repent and be baptized. But that is a message to Israel, to the little flock, to the flock of Israel, not to us. What do you want to repent of? Of your sins. Okay, you repent of your sins, which means you change your mind. No, they say repent, stop sinning. Okay, try. How's that working with you, you know, today when you woke up and you thought that your neighbor, you like to smash his face for whatever he did yesterday to in your backyard, whatever. You know, we are not capable. We must receive the gift. We must receive imputed righteousness. We must receive free salvation. Otherwise, there is no salvation. Another Jesus, they tell you all the time about, you know, Jesus in the four Gospels, which is true stuff, but it's true that he was talking to Israel. He said it. I'm not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. What? Yes. Yes. Even to his disciples and his apostles, the 12 apostles for 12 tribes, Jesus said, do not go to the Gentiles. Do not enter in the city of the Gentiles and the Samaritans. Go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel and preach and cast the devils and preach the kingdom of God, which was coming. But as you know, didn't come because they rejected the Lord, the King, Jesus, the Messiah. They rejected the King and the kingdom, and Israel is fallen. In Acts 7, when they reject the Holy Spirit that's speaking through the mouth of Stephen and they stone him to death, they practically strike one, strike two, strike three, because they rejected the Father in the Old Testament, Israel. You know, they rejected the Father in the Old Testament, they rejected the Son in the New Testament, and they reject the Spirit when in the Salient New Testament, in the book of Acts, in chapter 7, when they stoned Stephen, and they committed the unpardonable sin. You know, remember Jesus said, a sin that you and I cannot commit because we're not Israel. We already lost in ourselves. You know, Paul says very clearly, you know, I really hope that you can get this. You know, remember that time he says, wherein a new, he has quickened, who? God, who were dead in trespasses and sin. That's our condition, you know. Wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, who is Satan, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience, among whom also we had all our conversation in times past, in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desire of the flesh and of mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, this is very good, who is rich in mercy, thank you, Lord, is rich in mercy, for his great love wherein he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, has quickened us together with Christ. By grace he has saved and has raised up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And Paul is telling us, wherefore remember that you being time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, remember that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. I mean, this is a very, very sad and tragic condition to be in, you know, because we had nothing to do with Israel. God didn't make a covenant with me, with you, with the Gentiles. He made it with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, David, Moses, and so forth. You know, Moses, David, the prophet, the nation of Israel. When Jesus came to bring the new covenant, okay, which would be the new birth, they needed to be born again. We cannot be born again because we were never born by God anyway. We become eventually the new creature the moment we believe, but it's completely different. So you see, the confusion, master of confusion, is Satan, who is preaching another gospel. You know, in Galatians, let me go in Galatians. Galatians 1, Paul is very, very surprised. He said, you know, even though he says that Jesus gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world, which Satan is the prince of the power of the air, is the god of this world, according to the will of God and our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I marvel, says Paul, that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, kingdom gospel, which is not another. But be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. Why? Well, because the gospel of Christ is, he died for your sins, he risen for your justification, and the gospel of the kingdom is said, be repentant, be baptized in water, receive the Spirit, and go and sell all you have, give it to the poor, follow me into the kingdom. You can't follow Jesus into the kingdom. There is no kingdom. Jesus is ascended, is sitting at the right hand of God. The kingdom has been postponed for another time, another dispensation. But Paul says, hey, watch out, man. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let it be a curse. All right? If you follow the kingdom gospel or any other gospel but the gospel of Christ, you are under a curse. I'm sorry, I didn't say this. God says, and we said before to say, So say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that you have received, let him be accursed. Okay, two times God, through the Holy Spirit, through the pen of Paul, is telling us, if you are following another Jesus, another gospel, another spirit, if you are not in the gospel of grace, in the gospel of Christ, salvation by grace, with no works, by faith, by grace, you are under a curse. And that's not funny. That's not funny. That's not funny at all. So I just close with this. There is a lot to say about the enemy, but would be enough for you to understand that at the moment he has transformed into an angel of light. Don't forget this. So go away from, leave, you know, instead of going in places, buildings they call churches, Catholic, evangelic, or whatever, or follow any other religion, read other books, like, you know, you can read the Quran, the Bhagavad Gita, the whatever, all this. Just get for yourself a King James Bible. Go to the letters of Paul, from Romans to Philemon. Start reading Romans and ask the Lord, because God is good. He will answer this prayer. You know, this is a very important prayer, because he wants all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Say, Lord, teach me. And you will discover for yourself the stuff that I'm preaching here. That God is good, and his goodness endures forever. And he's a gracious God. And he has offered salvation, free salvation, to all men that simply believe and receive the gospel of Christ. And I close with the gospel of Christ. With the gospel of Christ. Which is, let's see, where did it go? Yeah, the gospel of Christ is here. Huh, praise God for that, you know. There is hope for the people that otherwise wouldn't have no hope. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand. Please analyze very simply words. Paul is preaching this gospel. You receive it. And when you receive, you stand, by which also you are saved. So that's what it saves you. If you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. Meaning, you know, don't change this gospel. Don't believe in vain, putting other things. For I deliver unto you first of all, so priority, that which I also received. Remember that Paul was the enemy of Christ. Remember, he was going to destroy all the Jerusalem church. Was not the body of Christ. There was no body of Christ yet. You know, that's a future thing. But still, he met the glorious Lord Jesus Christ, who came back in the regions of air and in a vision called him, saved him by grace. That's why Paul is the first and the pattern. From henceforth, anybody can get saved the same way, by grace through faith, the gift of God. And he says, how Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. And he was buried and he rose again according to the scriptures. What do you want to add to this? This is the work of God. Glory in the cross of Christ, not in the flesh and the religion of man. Glory in the cross of Christ. And just say, Lord, thank you to open my eyes, which were blinded by Satan, you know. Thank you very much. He will teach you, you know. I didn't go to some kind of Bible. I'm not a pastor. I'm not some guy, you know, brilliant man. Actually, the opposite. As a sinner, I was going to hell. I'm not going to hell now. Not because I reformed myself, because now I've become such a good guy, but because I simply received the gift of God, which is salvation by grace through faith, no works, thanks to the death, burial, resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. I wish you all a wonderful day, and I say bye-bye for now. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen.